which balloon costs $800?
Give yourself up and then you become whole. You're a slave to yourself and them don't even know. Run up to live the fast life, but your brain moves slow.
Reggae music is simple. It's about space. You know, each person doing the minimal thing, but putting their utmost into every single note. All the early reggae music comes from this place of struggle, and it comes from this place of looking back into the Bible to see, like, how people dealt with it. And the vibe of the music itself, it allows a person to get into a certain space. When the music puts the person in that space, those messages, those quotes and those lines, it just fits in there. It's like royal. I think I always just had a desire to express my life or whatever I was feeling, whatever I was going through music, you know? I would like sit and play the drum and freestyle rap in the parking lots and like rock concerts. Just so happens that someone had offered me a gig on Hanukkah. The rabbi lit this huge menorah like in Union Square. We had like really loud amplifiers. It was like rush hour. And I started singing, like beatboxing, making up the whole thing. And I just kind of like closed my eyes, like got into it, and then opened my eyes like 45 minutes later. There's like huge mass crowds of people and video cameras, and just that's how it started.
To the heavens with rise and the earth with the cult, and now you come swing back like a catapult.
When we started the shows, they became real high energy. The crowd, they wanted it to happen so badly, because those original crowds were like young Jews in New York. When they started hearing the music and they saw like who was doing it, instantly everyone was pulling for it. When we went out on tour, we had a van, we were just traveling, we were playing 6 nights a week, and we played like everywhere. And as we started getting further out, we started seeing in the concerts, the crowds totally changed. It's one of the things we pride, because you could have like a 70-year-old religious man standing next to like a 16-year-old, people just started to relate to me. As the whole thing happened, it felt like just pieces of a puzzle being put together. This is what's supposed to happen now. The King Without a Crown, basically the song I wrote when I was in yeshiva, and I was like studying Torah basically for 10, 11 hours a day. And living in this like dorm room in Brooklyn with these other guys for 2 years basically without listening to music, without watching TV. I came out from there one time in about a year and a half. I had a friend in Philadelphia with a studio. And I took the train there and we wrote this song. Like I wrote the lyrics in about 15 minutes. I just basically wrote out everything that I had been like thinking or I'd been going through in that year and a half in that yeshiva. On the train platform, coming home from that studio, and I had a playback on the CD, like just listening to it. I was like, this song is like really felt right. We're all very different. We all have like very different perspectives and philosophies.
This is Jonah David on the drums, Josh Warner on the bass.
Every person's personality becomes another force in the music. Sometimes when those forces are going against each other a little bit, part of that, it makes our band have a little bit of an edge, maybe that some bands don't have, because we're not all like best friends, but we all appreciate each other. Jerusalem is the place where I had a spiritual revolution. I went there when I was 16 years old, and I like sat on Mount Scopus. I watched over the old city as the sun set. I had a realization that I believe in God. Because up until that point, I had eaten acid at a fish concert. You know, I'd done different things that could be considered divine, you know, like having an experience outside of yourself. Jerusalem and my being Jewish was somehow at the core of who I am. I think a lot of people have that at some point in their life, some kind of realization about one thing or another. That's like that person's Jerusalem.
So, you know, we want to take a second just to acknowledge that this whole world, this whole reality is really just nothing. We're in the arms of the King.
As a religious Jew, we pray three times a day. The whole custom of song in prayer is universal, because throughout all of the history of time, there's been man trying to transcend himself, and there's been music for that. It's not just about, like, trying to have a career or trying to make money, and it's not just about entertainment, you know? But it's about using the voice, the power of song, to come through and just make some kind of connection.